So today we're going to have a quick talk about the differences in Karambits and the difference between American style ones, which were actually developed and made and produced, I believe, in America, but probably made in Taiwan or something like that, and some Filipino ones. Now, I did have some Malay and Indonesian ones. I believe they're at home. I just decided to do this video randomly today. As I just got back from the Philippines, and a lot of people had a lot of interest from this blade. You know, that I posted on Instagram, and you know, people got a combat boner over it or whatever. So yeah, a couple of differences, a couple of considerations, and some very common problems that you're going to run into training with blades like this that are obviously just training knives, okay, for Filipino martial arts and silat. But let me go over it real quick. First, when choosing one, my first actual consideration, which one thing I was going to mention, was do you actually carry it? You know, why are you actually training with this? You train it because it's an art, because it's part of the, you know, the arts and the traditional stuff and whatever, and it's just because it's interesting or it's cool or whatever. That's fine, that's great and everything. But for me, you'll see a few Karambit videos up, but you don't see a lot. You see more so knives, because that's what I'm actually carrying, whether it's on my rig, whether it's on one of my go bags or survival bags, kits, whatever you want to call it, at one of my caches, like this. You know, I'm actually, you know, training with the exact same thing that I'm using. Now, I don't often carry one as I am right now to show you, because they're quite awkward to carry. I like to carry it inside the waistband for EDC knives, especially like a folder like this, simply to avoid it falling out of my pocket or to avoid it from showing, like when you can see the clip here. And also because it's comfortable there, you can actually have full range of motion, sitting down, lying down, moving, whatever, you know, so that's why I actually put it there. But a Karambit, for example, especially a double-edged Karambit, you know, you don't want to put inside the waistband. You know, this one's outside the waistband, for example, like a lot of people will carry a gun. You can also carry it inside the waistband for concealed carry. But if you were to put it inside the waistband, see, like this, and your pants are here where my finger is, for example, and you're to pull out the knife, you're going to cut through your pants. So, you know, when I see people training and they just start off from here and it's just dueling sort of stuff, which is an element of, you know, everybody's training. You do, you know, one-for-one drills and all that sort of thing. That's fine. I understand that. But when I see them doing that and they don't actually look at, okay, how do we get there, you know, and if we're going to implement these skills or apply these drills or whatever, skills are developed from drills, so that's why I put it like that, just in case you haven't heard that from me before or it didn't make sense to you. I'm always saying drills develop skills, or they should, you know, and for us it's always got to be functional, practical, efficient, not just effective but efficient. Minimum effort, maximum effect. Yes. Minimum effort, maximum effect. Too much going on today, sorry for that. Point being is that I picked this up in the Philippines just recently, all right, this double-edged Karambit. And the first thing I look at with a blade is what holster it comes with. Now, I got this to show my students because it wasn't that expensive. It's incredibly illegal here. I'm surprised I got through with it. You know, I just took a chance, I thought, fuck it, whatever. It wasn't that expensive, as I said. But it felt all right in the hand, you know. And if I wanted to go to the effort, I could get a custom-made sheath. But the sheath that it came with, again, is a bit shitty. It's wooden. It doesn't fit really well. And because of the clip, when you look at it, it would only go on the outside of the waistband, like so. So to carry something like this outside the waistband, you can see when I go to carry it like this, when I go to, not just carry it, but, you know, pull it out, like so, it's the whole thing comes out like that. And it's not one where I can just flick it off, as you can see. Like you can some other holsters. I've got some other Kydex holsters on for this knife that I carry. And if I flick it, I can actually use that as a distraction as well. Anyway, point being is that if I actually like, really, really like a blade, one of the first things I do is look at, you know, if it's cost efficient, you know, if it's actually worth it, if it's not too dear, because, you know, if it gets taken off me, if it's get broken, or if I have to use it. The point is that, you know, I'm more of a realist than an idealist. For this one, you can actually attach it outside the waistband quite easily, and you'll see that because it's attached with malice clips, okay, you can look those up. I've done some other videos on those as well, and different carries. When I go to take that Karambit, it's out straight away. Now, this is the Hibbon Claw 2. Okay, this is a black one. I don't particularly like the silver one. I do have a version of that on another bag and another cache. But You know, I think for a practical karambit, this is a very good blade. It comes with an incredibly shitty sheath, in my opinion. It was a piece of leather that flopped around, the knife fell out all the time. It was much like the traditional one, it just had a clip on the outside, and I thought, this is really pointless. Very, very disappointing for the type of blade that it is. Now, you're not very inclined to do these flips or extensions or whatever you want to call them, right? One, because being a very, very sharp double-edged blade there, you are going to fucking cut yourself. You're going to learn very quickly, so I don't recommend that at all. Some people do it for flashy, you know, basically for show. Some people like to practice with that, but I don't really see the point. If I've got these knuckle bits hanging out, these knobby bits, I can break someone's teeth before I fucking slash their throat, and that's one thing we train for, even with your training knives here, which I'll get to in a second. But the point being is, this being double-edged is illegal in most states now, even in the US. Karambits have been outright banned in some places that I've taught. They asked me to do a karambit seminar, and they said, oh, actually, they're banned here. And I was like, why are you asking me to teach it then? Because, you know, I feel like it's not really honest of me to teach something that you can't even use. And they're like, oh, some of us carry it anyway, some of us whatever. And for me, I'm like, I don't actually carry a karambit. As I said, I put it on my survival bag, my go bag. We call them bobs, bailout bags, on cache heaps. Look up the other videos that I have on those for urban survival, please. There's a lot of great information there. But as I said, this one here is a cold steel FGX karambit, which is carbon fiber. I think it's great. Still actually quite sharp there. You can feel it. It does cut. We've done cutting tests on it. Definitely check out those videos as well. But it didn't come with a sheath, so I thought, fuck it. I ordered three or four, I think, and sent one to a sheath maker and said, I want a whole bunch of sheaths. I have some, these are from the same maker, actually, but I have some on, one on this bag, others on other bags at other caches that I have, and again, it's cheap, so it was only like, I think it was under $20, right? So if it got taken off me or I lost it, whatever. One actually did in Malaysia when I got detained. But it wasn't a criminal charge or anything, so it was good. But it got taken off me, and yeah, it didn't matter because I had about five or six more. So anyway, they are a decent knife. I think very cost effective. And if you're going to be like anyone like myself and have a bunch of these, you know, go bags, bailout bags, or bobs at caches, you know, it's good to have something on the front that you can rip out straight away. So, but that one there is a single edged. Now, when you're training, let's get to the training blade for a second. When you're training and you're going to pick a training blade, you know, you can pick something that feels good in your hand, that feels cool and everything, but you also want to be as close to the thing that you're actually carrying, okay? So you'll see a lot of the time we have these blades, they were actually cut down. So actually take down the edges off them and we'll train with them, as you can see in this video. Right, now those are live blades, they're the real blades, but we just took the edges off. Now, I didn't do it with these because they're actually hard to get. I tried to import six, they got taken off me. I go back and I grab a couple every time I'm in the States and I bring them back with me. So I don't bother cutting them down. But I can actually train with something like this that's double-edged and have somewhat similar sort of feel to it, right? But the thing is, if you're carrying a karambit or you've got a karambit which is has the blade or the cutting part, like that one on the inside, then that's how you want to play it. So I see a lot of guys doing this motion like this, for example, and it's like, there's no fucking blade there. Unless that's the one you're carrying, but they're not as common as the blades on the, being on the inside of the karambit. So, and even less common is those that have it on both sides. So you've got this one here, which is very, very generic. You'll find this, you know, with a lot of people who stock or sell Filipino martial arts equipment. But you've really got to decide which side are you playing. And I say playing because you are actually just role playing. You're not slashing any fucker in front of you, are you? Right, so that's my point. One thing you've also got to be aware of, I haven't used this one recently because I've actually got to smoothen it down. It's got a lot of bumps and scratches, nicks and whatever you want to call that, and that can actually cut people. It doesn't go to the point where it's a laceration, the guy's actually, you know, bleeding out and whatever, but it does leave a bit of a scar. I have seen that on students before. This one's actually still quite all right, you see? You'll get that from clanging them together or whatever, banging them together, whatever you want to call it. And yeah, you've just got to check your gear, okay? Make sure that it's safe, because you don't want to be training unsafe. The whole point of training is to keep yourself safe, right? Security actually means the maintaining of personal health and safety, okay? Can't even string a fucking sentence together today. Anyways, I hope that that has given you some information, some decent information to as to what you should be looking for. If you find a decent blade like me and you think, well, this is great, I like this blade, but it's a piece of shit holster, maybe look at getting a Kydex holster. I will say to you that all of the holsters that I've gotten for all of my knives have cost more than the actual blade itself. But that's the thing that makes a big difference. You know, if I pull that out, I know that's ready to go. That's right there. I know where it is, for example. So that means that it's reliable. You see what I mean? I'm always going to put things, you know, based on how I'm dressed, you know, accustomed to my attire, and based on the season. Here in Japan, it gets really fucking cold, in my opinion, because I'm from Australia originally. And, you know, in the winter, I can wear something like this, possibly if I feel I need to. A lot of the time, I just don't. But, you know, a fixed blade like this one, and also a folding knife and a neck one, I just took off on my necklace, is something I feel necessary. But anyway, definitely check out the other videos that I've put up on the EDC. Sort of lifestyle and mindset, the mentality, you know, and different ways that you can carry things you might want to consider, and also definitely check out the other videos on urban survival. Okay, if you want to learn more about survival, self-reliancy, self-protection, and combatives, definitely check out our online learning center at rawcombat.com for a free week-long trial.